Leia here from leiaforsci.com, and in this video, I will give you a thorough breakdown of the solvent types and their effects on substitution and elimination reactions. Your solvents will fall into three categories. You have polar protic, polar aprotic, and nonpolar solvents. You should be able to identify each type of solvent in order to determine what type of reaction will take place. We'll use water to explain polar protic. The water molecule has an oxygen covalently bound to two hydrogen atoms. While the bond is covalent, meaning the electrons are shared between the two atoms, because oxygen is highly electronegative, it will hog the electrons between oxygen and hydrogen, and this extra electron density makes the oxygen partially negative. Because the hydrogen atom has the bonding electrons pulled away from itself, the nucleus is partially exposed, giving each hydrogen a partial positive charge. A polar molecule is a molecule that has opposite poles, meaning negative and positive. If you analyze the water molecule, we have a distinct separation between the negative and the positive, where the oxygen portion of the molecule is considered the negative pole, and the hydrogen portion of the molecule is considered the positive pole. Protic kind of sounds like proton, and this has to do with hydrogen bonding. So let me ask you a question. Do you like to have fun? Because hydrogen does, specifically F, O, or N. If you have a hydrogen atom bound to either a fluorine, oxygen, or nitrogen, and you place it near another fluorine, oxygen, or nitrogen, these atoms will attract the hydrogen so strongly that it's almost impossible to tell which was the original atom bound to hydrogen. Fluorine is less likely to show up in your polar protic solvents, but definitely look out for the oxygen and nitrogen, such as what we have in water. If I bring another water molecule nearby, the partial negative oxygen from the second water will be attracted to the hydrogen on the first water molecule, forming a very strong interaction or a hydrogen bond. Therefore, a polar protic solvent is a solvent that has either oxygen or nitrogen directly attached to a hydrogen atom. This will make the hydrogen partially positive and able to interact with any other molecule that is dissolved in the solution. Common polar protic solvents include water and ammonia, or larger molecules that have an OH or NH, for example, alcohols or amines. Again, the key here is that the hydrogen has to be bound directly to the oxygen or to the nitrogen, and not to some other atom like carbon or sulfur. Since polar protic solvents have partial negative and partial positive on every solvent molecule, they tend to favor charges dissolved in solution. If you consider an SN1 or E1 reaction, the carbocation intermediate that forms is not very stable. However, if you place that carbocation into a polar protic solution, the partial negative atom of the solution will stabilize that positive charge by donating some of its electronegativity. At the same time, when the leaving group leaves, it will form a negative charge in solution. For example, if Br- is my leaving group, it forms a negative charge in solution, which is stabilized by the partially positive end of the polar protic solvent molecules. So when you see a polar protic solvent, consider a one type, meaning an SN1 or E1 reaction. SN2 reactions will be unfavorable in this type of solvent because a strong nucleophile will be blocked on its way trying to attack the molecule. Polar protic solvents treat E2 and SN2 reactions completely differently. If you have a molecule with a leaving group, that molecule will be partially positive and therefore attract the nucleophile. However, if I try to bring a very strong nucleophile into solution to attack that carbon, the solvent tends to get in the way of the nucleophile, thereby preventing the reaction. The nucleophile, recall, is going to be partially negative. This will attract the partially positive end of solvent molecules surrounding that nucleophile and thereby preventing it from attacking. In other words, an SN2 reaction will likely not take place in a polar protic solvent. Not only will the nucleophile be hindered by the solvent, if it's negative enough, it can actually react with the solvent, attacking a solvent molecule instead of the reactant, thereby destroying the ability of that nucleophile. But this is very different when considering an elimination reaction. If you have a very strong base and you dissolve it in its own conjugate solvent, for example, if we take OH- dissolved in H2O, water is simply the conjugate base of OH-. So if the OH- steals a hydrogen from another water molecule, all that leaves me with is another OH-. So eventually one of these strong basic molecules will wind up attacking the beta hydrogen, causing that elimination reaction to take place. So again, polar protic solvents will prefer the E1, SN1, or E2 reactions, but will not favor the SN2 reactions. A polar aprotic solvent is still going to be polar, meaning we'll have that separation of charge on the molecule. However, the prefix A implies without or missing, and that means that a polar aprotic solvent, even though it has that separation of charge, will not have a hydrogen on oxygen or nitrogen, and therefore will not be able to donate a hydrogen for hydrogen bonding. There are four common examples that you will likely have to memorize. I will show you the structure so that you understand what you're looking at, but you don't have to know how to draw it as long as you recognize these molecules to be polar aprotic. The first is Dmso, which stands for dimethyl sulfoxide. We have a sulfur double bound to an oxygen, and the sulfur is also bound to two methyl groups. Since oxygen is a lot more electronegative than sulfur, oxygen will pull electron density away from sulfur, making it partially negative, and leaving the sulfur partially positive. However, notice that the hydrogens on this molecule are attached to carbon and not oxygen or nitrogen, meaning that these hydrogens cannot participate in hydrogen bonding. DMF stands for dimethylformamide, which is actually NN-dimethyl, given that the nitrogen has two methyl groups attached. Notice that we have both oxygen and nitrogen on this molecule, which will be partially negative, leaving the carbon partially positive. However, once again, the hydrogens show up bound to carbon rather than oxygen or nitrogen, making the solvent unable to donate protons for hydrogen bonding. Acetone is simply the common name for propanone, which has a carbon double bound to an oxygen and once again two methyl groups. And if you're familiar with ketones, you'll know that oxygen is partially negative and carbon partially positive. Once again, a polar molecule with no hydrogens to donate for hydrogen bonding. And lastly, we have acetonitrile, which has a carbon triple bound to a nitrogen, leaving that nitrogen very partially negative and the carbon partially positive. Now, these are not the only polar aprotic solvents, but these are the most common ones that come up when studying substitution and elimination reactions. Here's an interesting trend that you want to consider. When analyzing halogens as nucleophiles, the solvent will make a difference. In the last video, we said that the smaller halogens tend to be stronger nucleophiles, and that's because their charge is more concentrated. We also said that a larger halogen is more polarizable, making it an ideal nucleophile. So which is it, small or large? In a polar aprotic solvent, there are no partially positive hydrogens to stabilize or slow down a halogen from reacting, making the smaller, more concentrated charge the stronger halogen. That makes F- stronger than Cl-, which is stronger than Br- and stronger than I-. However, analyzing this same sequence in a polar protic solvent is going to give you the reverse. And that's because the polar protic solvent will surround or cage these halogens as follows. Fluoride, which is tiny, when surrounded with a molecule like water, will be completely caged and unable to attack. However, iodine, which is rather large, will still be partially surrounded by the water molecules, but because it's so big, it's still able to get out of that cage and attack. That makes iodine the largest halogen, the strongest nucleophile in a polar protic solvent, but in a polar aprotic solvent, where there is nothing to cage it, the fluoride, or smallest halogen, will be your strongest nucleophile. Given that the polar aprotic solvent does not have as strong of an ability to stabilize attacking molecules, it will favor a stronger reaction like SN2. Recall that a polar protic solvent can destroy a strong nucleophile by reacting with it, but the nucleophile has no hydrogen to attack in an aprotic solvent. So whenever you see a polar aprotic solvent, consider the SN2 reaction over an E2 reaction. And finally, we have the nonpolar solvent, which, as the word implies, is not polar at all. This occurs when a molecule typically has just carbon and hydrogen with no exciting functional groups. Common examples for solvents are going to include toluene, which is simply a benzene ring attached to a CH3, or you might see something like hexane, which is six carbons in a chain. These are ideal solvents when you have hydrophobic molecules, meaning molecules that have no polarity, no charge, and therefore fear water. And a nonpolar solvent does not stabilize any intermediate charges, so you will have to consider your two-type reactions, meaning your SN2 and E2. You want to think of the two-type reactions because the leaving group does not want to leave on its own, knowing that the charge that forms will not be stabilized. But if you bring a strong base or nucleophile, it will act as a bully, disregarding the happiness of the leaving group and simply attack and kick it out. Overall though, you're more likely to see polar protic or aprotic solvents rather than nonpolar solvents in your substitution and elimination reactions. Be sure to join me in the next video, where I show you how to analyze leaving groups in substitution and elimination reactions.
Are you struggling with organic chemistry? Are you looking for information to guide you through the course and help you succeed? If so, download my ebook, 10 Secrets to Acing Organic Chemistry, using the link below, or visit leahforsythe.com/orgosecrets. That's O-R-G-O secrets. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and even share it with a friend or two. If you have any questions regarding this video, leave a comment below or contact me through my Facebook page at facebook.com/leahforsythe. There will be many related videos posted over the course of the semester, so go ahead and click the subscribe button to ensure that you don't miss out.